Welcome to Ask GMBN Tech. This is our weekly Q&A session. If you've got any questions, let us know in the comments below, but please use the hashtag AskGMBNTech if you're asking a question, because it makes it super easy for us to find them and add you on next week's show. If you'd rather send us an email, the email address is right there at the bottom of the screen, hellotech@gmbn.com. Get cracking. Okay, so this one's from Gabrielle Alexander. Can you give a basic bike geometry introduction? I have no idea how a shorter chainstay or longer wheelbase or anything like that affects how a bike rides. Yeah, of course we can do that. This is a huge topic, and I think it is one that deserves its own video. But for now, I'm going to go old school and get a pen and a bit of paper and do a very bad sketch of a bike and just show you a few things in here. I'm gonna tell you exactly what they are and roughly what they do and what it means to you when you're riding. Okay, so firstly, let's look at the basic geometry of a bike. So we'll do bottom bracket height first. Now, if I was gonna draw a horizontal line, it would go between the wheel axles and you would measure. There's two ways of measuring this. You get bottom bracket drop, which is from that line down to the bottom bracket axle itself. And then there's bottom bracket height, which is the height of the bottom bracket axle to the floor on that axis. So that is your height. Now you'll see bottom bracket height referred to in manuals and spec sheets on websites. The lower the bottom bracket is, the more stable your bike will feel. The higher it is, the more agile it will feel. Pretty simple. Now the chainstay length, that is a measurement from your rear wheel axle to your bottom bracket. That is this measurement here. Or should I say, this measurement here. Now, the shorter the bottom bracket is, the easier the front end lifts, the more traction you directly get. However, if it's too short, the bike can feel unbalanced. If they have a nice long chainstay, i.e. your axle's further out, you're gonna get more weight on the front wheel, so it can give you more front wheel grip. But as a trade-off to that, it's gonna be harder to lift the front wheel. So you end up having to have a higher handlebar. Okay, so that's getting a bit complex. So I'm just gonna move this aside. So we've got another one I've already drawn here. Now, so to go along with your chainstay length, you also have wheelbase. So that's calculated from the rear wheel axle. So let's draw a line here. And the front wheel axle, that is your wheelbase. Now you might also hear front center used. That is the measurement from your front axle to your bottom bracket. So you have front center, you have chainstay, and you have total wheelbase. The longer a bike is, the more stable it is. The shorter it is, the more agile it is. But also, it can feel very nervous when it's short. Likewise, it can feel very lazy when it's long. Now, the next two things I'll talk about are angles. Now, you hear about the seat angle and the head angle. They're both very important to how a bike rides. The seat angle is representative of, imagine a line going from this axle here, which is your fulcrum of the bike, up to where your saddle is based. Now that angle is calculated from the flat ground that you're on. So you get a steeper angle or a slacker angle. Now a slacker angle, traditionally, you would have seen on road bikes and other bikes for comfort. The slacker the angle is, the less that shocks are transmitted from the ground to the rider. However, on a mountain bike, this is not important. What is important is having a steeper angle, because when you're climbing and you're going up steep terrain, it means your saddle stays closer over your crank for good weight distribution onto the front wheel and a good climbing position, which means you can really use your legs to maximum advantage. So the steeper the seat angle is, the better a bike will climb off-road. Now the last one I want to talk about is the head angle. So this is effectively the angle from here to here, running through here. And it's measured in exactly the same way. The slacker a head angle is, the more relaxed a bike will feel, more stable it feels at speed. The steeper it is, the more agile it will feel, the more responsive it will feel. But also, when you're riding fast or steep terrain, it can feel a bit nervous and a bit twitchy. Now, to get all of these elements correct together can be very hard. You can't just make a bike with a nice long chainstay, a steep seat angle, and a good head angle, because you mess with the whole geometry of the bike. Now, the final thing I want to talk about is not an angle, it's a measurement called reach. Now, this is something that's commonly misunderstood, but it's actually very important, and it refers to basically the length of a bike. Now, you get various different ways to measure the length of a bike, but the reach simply is a vertical line that goes through the bottom bracket axle. This is supposed to be a vertical line, excuse my drawing here. And it's the horizontal measurement that goes to the center of the frame. So between here and here, give or take. That is the reach, and it's a bit more of a universal measurement to work out the distance between here and here, which is more accurate than just measuring the top tube, because that only really counts when you're sat on the bike because of the fact the seat angle varies. This measurement will always be the same. That's why the reach is a good one to understand what works for you. A 500mm reach is about perfect for me, and it's a good idea to sort of get an idea on what works for you, because then you can start comparing bikes and try to understand what's going to work for you. Okay, and one more just to summarize all these points. You have your wheelbase, which is calculated from center of the front wheel axle to center of the rear wheel axle. You have your front center, that is a measurement from the bottom bracket axle to the front wheel axle. You have your chainstay length, which is your bottom bracket axle to the rear wheel axle. The seat angle, quite simply, is an imaginary line between the bottom bracket axle and the top of the frame there. Now, the misleading thing on some bikes is if you have a frame design unlike this one that has an interrupted or curved tube. Don't be drawn into looking at the tube too much. You need to just basically do the plumb line to get that. And then there's the head angle, which is the steering axis up front. And they all have big effects on how a bike handles. But there's much more we can cover in a lot more detail, because there's further things to talk about like offset, stack, trail, all those sort of things. And we'll get into that on a detailed video soon. Byron Farrington, can you have a SRAM mech but a Shimano shifter? Sometimes it is possible, but it's not always that simple. So it does depend on a particular sort of speed transmission you have, because they're going to pull different amounts of cable. So a rear derailleur on 10 speed, Shimano pulls 3.4 millimeters of cable, SRAM pulls 3.1 millimeters of cable, and for 11 speed it's 3.6 and 3.48. So as you can see, there is difference between the two. Now the cassettes themselves have the same pitch, so you can use a SRAM cassette on a Shimano system and vice versa, which is why you see brands like YT, for example, specking E13 cassettes in place of a SRAM cassette. It's not about the brand you pick, it's about the speeds that you pick. However, if you are really interested in mix and matching your componentry, like your SRAM and your Shimano, with, in particular, with the shifter and mech combinations like you're talking about, there's a really cool little invention called the JTEC ShiftMate. This is it on the screen here. Now, it's various different amounts, and it basically has a cam in it and compensates for different amounts of cable pull, so you could use a certain SRAM shifter with a certain Shimano rear derailleur. So this is a really cool little bit of kit. Now, on screen now is just a screen grab from Arts Cyclery. I'm gonna put a link to that in the description below this video. You should definitely go over to their site and check it out. It's a really, really good resource for looking at all the stuff like cable pull between different derailleurs, different shifters, the pitch basically you get between different cassette sprocket spacings, all of that sort of stuff. So you can actually fine tune and work out the exact ones that you want to try yourself. And let us know actually what you get on with if you end up using one of those JTEC ShiftMates. I've never used one, I just know that they exist. So I'd be dead keen to find out if it works and it works out well for you. Good luck. Next up's from Live Your Dreams. Is it possible to use a tapered fork on a straight tube, as in a straight frame? If it's possible, is it safe? Well, it totally depends on the head tube size you have on your particular bike. Yeah, you can use a tapered in a straight head tube. If you've got a 44mm head tube, you can do that. If you've got 1.5, you can do that. But it completely depends on your particular frame and what headset options there are available. I'm going to throw a link in the description below to the Cane Creek headset finder, and it's a really, really useful tool I always talk about. And it means you can input your frame, you can put your fork in there, and it will find a headset combination to see if that is compatible in there. But if your headset tube is 1 1/8 and your steerer tube is 1 1/8 straight, you're not going to find a way of getting a tapered one in there. And also one thing to note, never try and use external headset cups on an internal style frame. I've heard some horror stories about people pressing those in and they either crack or they crack and damage the frame. Not safe either. This is a puzzling one from Kim OP, and I'm not sure I know the correct answer actually for this. Dry or wet lube on chains when temperatures are sub-freezing? Well, for starters, I think there's a couple of schools of thought on this. So, a wet lube, in theory, shouldn't freeze because it's got oil in it anyway. And also, in theory, the wet lube itself will drive away any moisture that could freeze, i.e. rain or mist or anything like that. So that school of thought would suggest that using a wet lube should be fine in sub-zero temperatures. But at the same time, a dry lube, really the only thing that's a liquid in it at all is the solvent that gets those lubricating particles into place. That will evaporate or dry into a film, and that shouldn't freeze either. However, if you're riding in sub-zero temperatures and that gets washed away, the moisture from the water or anything that washes it away is likely to freeze. So technically, I think you should go for wet, and I would say wet lubricant is the best for that. But I'm actually really keen to find out from anyone that does ride in sub-zero temperatures a lot, because it's not something we get a lot over here. We get a few cold days of snow, perhaps two or three a year, and it's enough to turn our country to a standstill, which is pretty amusing considering half the rest of the world has got insane levels of snow and everything functions correctly. So I'm really keen to find out what people use in genuine sub-zero temperatures. Maybe you're a fat biker from somewhere extreme like Alaska, I don't know. Give me some feedback, guys. I'd love to know from all you people that ride in super cold temperatures. Tell me what else is affected as well. Your tire pressure affected? Does your suspension react differently? Anything that reacts differently, I'd love to know a bit more about it. Alternatively, drop me an email at hellotech@gmbn.com. Love to hear from you. There we go, there's another weekly Ask GMBN Tech in the bag. If you've got any questions, let us know in those comments. Don't forget to use the hashtag AskGMBNTech if you've got any questions specifically for this show to go on next week's show. And if you want to see a couple more great videos, click down here for my sort of Pandora's box of cool kit that I like to have in addition to my toolkit. And click down here if you want to see Blake's bike that the crazy nutter raced the Valparaiso Urban Downhill on. As always, don't forget to give us a huge thumbs up if you love GMBN Tech, and don't forget to subscribe and share.